He told me to pronounce his name as J.P. Bader, and if I was having trouble pronouncing it, it was to think of Darth Vader, but replace it with a V. So with that being said, please help me in welcoming J.P. Bader, and he will give a talk that the title is now gone. He'll introduce the talk.
All right. Hi, everybody. Thank you all for coming. My name is J.P. Bader, and I'm going to talk about digital signal processing using a player piano. This is a lot of fun for me. It's not been so fun for my wife, who's been amazing to this point. So thank you all for coming and listening. She's going to give me evil eyes the entire time. But I need a big round of applause for her. Everybody say thank you. All right. A couple of things, real quick. I'm J.P. Bader. I'm the founder and president of Next Health Choice. We're a company that focuses on streamlining and automating prior authorizations. A prior authorization was a tool created by insurance companies to help control costs. Unfortunately, over the last several decades, it's become this pervasive bureaucratic nightmare for healthcare providers. So over the last 4 years, we've been creating automation to centralize and create efficiencies in prior authorizations, marching towards real-time coverage verification and using natural language processing and interactive voice response. So a lot of nothing that I'm going to show you has anything to do with what I do professionally. I'm a recovering software engineer. I'm no longer allowed to touch production-level code for a good reason. But a lot of what I'm doing here is actually, I get being the person who runs the company and being post-technical, I get to greenfield ideas, and then I get to hand them off very, very quickly to my team, who says, "Go back to doing what you do," which is not writing code. But it's so that's my professional life. Might be wondering why the hell am I here with a player piano with a circuit board strapped to it, plus a shop vac, 255 watt-hour batteries on a tubular steel frame. This is a passion and a hobby of mine. Frankly, there's a lot of reasons why I wanted to do this, but the two biggest reasons, one, slightly up because of work and doing interactive voice response and digital signal processing. But secondly, if you didn't hear just a few minutes ago me playing the piano, I have a degree in piano performance. I love playing the piano. This whole contraption is Rev 4 of my player piano platform, or my player piano platform, where I want to be able to busk anywhere I want to go, and so I have a piano to do that. But I'm in a garage band, which is really hard when you're a classical pianist, and you read everything, and I'm a very visual learner, and as my wife will attest, I'm a terrible listener, and I can't learn aurally. So when I hear people playing music, I can't even play Happy Birthday correctly because I can't hear it right. I can read it, no problem. I can play anything I read, but I can't hear it. So kind of what born out of this, what created this was I want to be able to play the piano and have fun playing the piano in my rock band and actually sound somewhat better than just a classical pianist playing Brahms or Rachmaninoff. And I wanted to be able to hear and see maybe like the soloist playing on the guitar riff, and I could see that here on the piano. And so that's kind of what was the birth process of a lot of this, being able to abstract from any kind of song, any kind of audio file, what I wanted to be able to perform on a piano, and then I can do it myself. That gives me the visual representation to do it. Now, I am, I've got some, I should apologize, I'm a terrible slide maker. I'm horrible at this, so a couple of things about me that also are reasons why this is happening. I build things all the time, much to my wife's chagrin. I built a chicken coop in our backyard. I built a 7-foot-tall Lego Man costume last year. I build things because that's fun. I'm terrible at documenting because that's not fun. So as a programmer, this is probably why I'm not a programmer anymore, is because I'm terrible at documenting. But you know, as an overeducated redneck, I do a lot of fun things in my mind, which my wife is like, that's stupid or dangerous, which is more fun. You know, but I have a lot of fun doing these things. And I collect instruments. This is actually, I was at one point 6 different pianos. I'm down to 3. And it's not a matter of where they go, it's just can I get them there? I want to set expectations for this talk. This is definitely pre-production. This is before pre-production. This is an alpha. What you're going to see here somewhat works. I have lost a lot of sleep. To quote Star Wars, many lives were lost getting us to this point. It was a lot of fun, but there's we have a manifold with four arrays of 22 solenoids on each one being powered by a Raspberry Pi Zero, running Wi-Fi that I'm going to shell into, send commands, as well as copy files over to, make this play, and a vacuum's going to run because I blew the vacuum 3 days ago. So this is a shop vac that I found laying around. If any of you are in Chicago or you have a makerspace that's nearby, please, please become a member. Use them, abuse them. It's great. It saved my life on this. They just need better mattresses there. Also, okay, so without any further ado, all right, some of the challenges I've had in getting to a digital signal processing that allows me to play this all on a player piano. I had a lot of challenges, as you can imagine. I knew nothing about digital signal processing when I proposed this. I actually said, this would be fun. Isn't this easy? Not at all. I have learned a lot, but I went down so many wrong rabbit holes that I know as programmers, none of us ever do that. We all find a problem, we solve it, and we move on. Except for my case, I found so many cool rabbit holes, and I kept digging into them, thinking there's something cool there. It turns out there are really cool things there, but not really appropriate to just write the freaking code. So I had to actually rebuild my player piano, and this player piano doesn't have a vacuum underneath. Pianos actually work really cool. This is a 110-year-old player piano. It's really amazing that it's built on vacuums, and things are machined to, you know, they use tenths of inches because they're not scientific, and but things are milled extremely precisely. But these rubber hoses are 100-plus years old. They snapped when you touched them. I got this off somebody's back porch. And so I had to rebuild a lot of this. I took the vacuum system out. I'm now running a shop vac, so I apologize. Anybody in the back, I don't know if you'll be able to hear the piano being played or not. You might hear a shop vac. If you do hear just the shop vac, you're sitting too far back. So then we have vacuums. Audio conversion. That was actually somewhat tricky, not tricky. In this realm of the things I'm going to talk about in as far as DSP goes, I didn't invent a single algorithm. As any good smart programmer did, I found other smarter people and used their code. And so this talk is actually going to go through several of the different libraries I had. I'm going to use one song in particular to just show the examples of how these libraries have different ways of taking their sounds apart. There are many rabbit holes like the Music Information Retrieval Society, or MIR. That was one rabbit hole I went down, as well as like trying to learn at Fourier, which I think is almost the next slide. And then hardware for the player piano itself. This circuit board here was just a nightmare that we got working this week. And the people who helped me with it, they went to a different conference. They're like, they didn't want to be within 500 miles of me. So I don't blame them. All right. So DSP is a huge, huge, huge field, of which I, admittedly, was extremely naive as to me solving this problem right away. But DSP is used in a lot of different things, not just audio engineering, but for animal communications, NSA spying, machine fault tolerances. But in the realm of audio, this is really where I'm going to focus on, just as to take sound. Again, separate out the important parts to me, like the guitar soloist or a singer, and be able to put that into a format that I could then play on here. I don't know if you can see that very well. That's my blackboard, or whiteboard right behind me. This is the maths I was learning over the last 4 months. This is a different rabbit hole. Fourier transform. This is me trying to figure out Fourier transform, and I'm not a math major. But Fourier, oh. There's some notes in here I didn't mean to leave up there, but the Fourier transform is actually quite a fascinating thing. It's really cool. In the realm of music, what is a sine wave? A sinusoidal wave is a representation of the frequency that a note is traveling at. If I'm playing an A440, that is really out of tune, but the idea is that is traveling at 440 hertz, which is giving us a sine wave that, if you just represent that alone, it's got a very unique signature. And if we were to take that, Fourier did a lot of cool math a few hundred years ago, and he didn't quite get banished, but a lot of people ignored him for a while. But his math was spot on being able to help us identify sound and sound fingerprints. If we take the frequency at which sound travels and we take the cycles per second and match them up, we actually get something that's similar to what's called an epicycle. The idea that sound can travel around in a graphical pattern. So not only do you have a sine wave going up and down, but if we were to twist that around in a circle, we get a very unique signature for any sound that we hear. And Fourier allows us to then say, all right, we have a fingerprint for any sound. What does that fingerprint look like? So A has a different signature than B flat. And if we take a lot of sounds together, we might have a representation of sound, but Fourier would allow us to see the epicycle variations on each note, and we can extract the sounds from that. I'm talking about this mainly just so you can know the algorithms. This is the rabbit hole I went down because I had to understand the algorithms that I was then going to be using, which, again, I'm not inventing algorithms because there are smarter people who do that. We have Euler, who has some great math that helps in the epicycles. And then Fourier creates, he's got fast Fourier transform. There's a QFT, STFT, which is a short time Fourier transform. There's a CFT. There are lots of different variations of us being able to pull sounds apart. And so I was able to learn a lot of this. Again, back to that previous photo of my desktop and my whiteboard, it's really hard on my brain to wrap my head around all this math, but it was fun times for my family included. Getting beyond that, and I'm going to get to some examples very, very shortly, because the rest of my talk really is examples, and I'm just going to go through the libraries I've talked about. But I used a couple of tools like Audacity and Sonic Visualizer to help demonstrate what the sounds look like from people who've been doing this long enough. They can, audio engineers, what they're looking at and what they see. And so we have some great tools, free open source tools, as well as some plugins that allow us to pull apart sounds. There are some commercial grade applications that if you want to pay a few $100, you can get to look at what sound waves are. But one of the problems I ran into, and everybody's, as naive as I am, was like, oh, you want to be able to just know the note that's being played in a song at any point in time? And it's not that easy. It's really, really hard. And it's really hard because computers don't see timbre, pitch velocity, quantization of sound. They get this mash of notes and audio frequencies. And you can create spectrograms. You can create visualizations, heat maps, where the noises are, chromographs. But it's really hard to actually get a computer to understand, an A major chord is different than somebody who's singing an A major chord or three people singing it. And then if you have that alongside with a section of guitars or bass or other instruments, suddenly you have a conglomeration of sound. Monophonic single voice music is really easy in comparison to a symphony. And then you get more complex situations where you have people adding special effects, reverb, auto-tuning. All these things are, I would say, catastrophic in the realm of DSP and where you want to, again, extract a signal from the sound you're trying to create. Okay, so that is it for my slides, the boring part. All right, I'm going to now mirror my screen and show you my Jupyter notebook, and I hope all of you can appreciate it. Is that it? All right. So this is my... All right. So we're going to go right into examples. And I'm going to just walk through what the sounds, how I got to the place where I am now. These are all the rabbit holes I kind of went down that allowed me to learn a lot of what DSP is and also what it isn't and what I wanted to do and not do. So some basic stuff. Python's got cake baked in a wave library, which is really great, and you should explore that. I was able to start taking some audio files and start instantly playing with it. And this allowed me to start seeing, what's the frequency, what is how many channels are in there. This is a lot of basic information about a music file. It's not expected that, from Wave library, I'm not going to get, this is a lot of what the computer would see and how you're translating that out, skipping down. This actually didn't work for my charting, so I apologize. But this is just basic concepts of just, all right, Python has a WAV file. You can convert MP3s to WAV. It works really well. Visualizations. All right, so now math. I'm sucky at math. I'm very sorry. Very important, NumPy, matplotlib. Thank you to anybody who's contributing to those. All right, so here we go. We're starting to see some of what the sine waves look like. And this is not an example of, if we dug down and looked at every single note throughout the song, you'd see a lovely sine wave pattern going on. This is actually a representation of every note all at once for all the entire song plotted out onto a chart. And these are all the different frequencies that you're going to see inside of a song. You can filter for just what you're trying to identify as a main signal. And actually, part of what I was doing here was not even at a song point. I believe at this point, I'm using examples from David Beasley, who is showing how the Kansas City autotone can be used to record data on a computer that's older than I think everybody in this room. Not everybody, but you know, how magnetic tapes were recording audio data and using that, how you're getting data in and out of it. And really, the signal was, if there was a flat signal, you had a certain, there's no data being transmitted. The moment you have a spike, and if you think of modems 20 years ago, the annoying sound, they were just using signals and sending data, transmitting data, audio. So, yay, more examples. All right, some basic DSP examples. Okay. Right. Which chart is this? This is just plotting frequencies for a song. Now I'm actually, at this point, I believe, using the song I'm actually working on for the entire rest of this is Bruce Springsteen did a great cover of Old Dan Tucker in the Seeger Sessions. If you haven't heard it, I insist you all listen for just one quick second. I don't know if there's audio. Does it play? It's not playing any audio? All right. No, I don't have any audio. No audio coming out of my laptop. That's okay, though. I'll save you the rest. You know, if I didn't mention it earlier, I'm going to ruin music as far as what people are used to listening to. So it's better that you don't hear how good that song is. So when you hear how bad I play it, you'll think it sounds great. There are things that we're trying to capture, all right, the different sounds that are coming out, and again, this is some of the Fourier transforms that are going through. This is how sound degrades over time. So as you have sound signals that are going over a certain period of time, you'll start sending out signals, and then one of the problems that you have with DSP and audio signals is I might play an A440, but it also resonates across a lot of other signals, different notes, and you're going to pick up the resonance of the different notes. So I might play A440. It's also vibrating the A220 and any other sympathetic notes that are going to go in there. Computers, again, have a hard time being able to pull that apart. And so you could see, even though I might be playing a note right in the middle through this chart, it's actually showing gradations of change and signal loss. So the next one is actually a spectrogram, visualization of sound that allows you to see. We have two different channels going on here. What I try to separate here are what should be vocal lines and percussive lines. And it looks really dark, so I apologize. When I'm done with this talk, all of these will be online, and you can play with these notebooks as much as you want and break everything and yell at the authors, not me. But this is just ways, again, of seeing what this data looks like. I skipped example 4 because it was broken. Okay. Getting to the actual meat of what I want, you know, playing this on the circuit board, not only is it important to know how to visualize or extract the specific sounds from the player piano, we have to know important things about the song, like what's your beats per minute, what's your tempo. A lot of the quantization of the sounds isolation is knowing inside of a specific time frame what are the notes that are happening at that time frame, and how can you then take a sample and then spread that across the rest of the song? So several of the libraries I've been using now have to help me figure out what's the beats per minute in a song, what's the ability for me to know how fast or slow am I playing something, and that allows me to figure out, am I listening to a banjo playing or am I listening to a singer singing? They might sound the same to a computer because they're in the same vocal range or same auditory range, but they have different timbres. Again, more code. This is a library called Aubio. This was allowing me to actually find out, all right, within this song, we have a specific frequency that we're running approximately 98, you know, beats per minute. This is more fun when I get to start comparing different libraries and knowing from Aubio, or I have a different library called Librosa, or a different library called Mido. Are they close? Are they accurate? They're using different algorithms to come to a conclusion. How close do I get to knowing that information? All right. So now we're into actual melody extraction. And this is where I'm not sure if the audio might be good if I could pull it up. I might just have to pull it out of the cable out so I get audio off my laptop. I don't know if that'll work. Oh, it's coming out my the display mini port. That one? All right. Oh, they're going to plug me into something different. Yeah, no, that just...
There you go. That's exactly what you want.
Yeah, well, that's coming out of here. Perfect. Okay. Huzzah. All right, so this is... I'll give it a second. So I'm going to now ruin music, and everybody's going to hear how great Bruce Springsteen is and how ungreat digital signal processing is when you're trying to make Bruce Springsteen play on a piano. When he doesn't want you to. All right.
Now, Dan Tucker was a fine old man. Washed his face in a frying pan. Combed his hair with a wagon wheel. And died with a toothpick in his heel. Get out the way, old Dan Tucker. You're too late to get your song.
Okay, it's a great song. I played a lot, too often at times. At this point, running what this outputs, and I'm going to be bad at live coding some of this. I apologize. But if I'm going to do this real quickly, I apologize for live coding. It's not what I was hoping to do. But we're going to call this AB for a second. Well, then, I'm just going to call it AB. I'm sorry. We want the input file. I'm going to go to example output. I'm going to call it example AB.MIDI. This is just examples of doing some melody extraction. It worked. Huzzah. All right. Okay, so now let's look at my example of outputs. There we go. This is what...
If you gave 88 children a lot of alcohol and one key to play, this is where it starts sounding. But you can hear the melody, right? So it's going on in there, but we're extracting the melody line against a mandolin or a banjo that's playing this. And it's got to be able to pull the sounds apart. And then we're also only going for the foreground notes. All right, it's distracting. We're going for the foreground notes and not the background notes, which is actually a really complex situation. So I'm going to... jump, I guess. No, save. That's fine. All right. Now, whatever I do... No, wrong save. Whatever I do put on into my notebooks and put up to Git, I don't know if those will be actually... you'll have to probably use your own sound files because I don't think I'm allowed to share for copyright reasons. Okay. So, did this go into the right one? Did I use the wrong... I should be going to example 7. It's a good thing I have the other ones right here. All right. Mel power. This is a wonderful way of seeing what we call in here. That was a mel chart. So, again, the coloring is really hard to see, but this is now starting to get into a lot of what sometimes in commercial grade applications, but also what you might see in Audacity, is ways that you can represent the sound in different levels, and you kind of get a heat map. It's a little hard to see, but you can see some orange dots going in there near the middle to around the 512 range all across the bar. That's more of a representation of the singer's voice being spotted throughout at different levels throughout time than it is the other instruments you hear. And when I played the original song, you heard a lot of bass, you had guitar, and those are different sounds that are going to be percussive and start lining up. All right, I'm halfway through my examples. I've got 15 minutes to go. I'm going to do my best to not put you to sleep. All right. Now, extracting harmonic or the percussive, the harmonic parts from the percussive parts is another part of the DSP that's really important to do. Otherwise, you start getting weird noises that aren't even close. Visually speaking, you can see at the top chart here, you've actually got the harmonic parts going on.
which are the singing, the guitar, any kind of musical intonations, while the percussive, and you can see it's there are vertical lines of notes. Those are the percussive beats, the drumming, the bass line. That gives a sense of moving forward. So this is one of the first times where now we're talking about separating some of the sound and separating it in a way that's not just that's visual at this point in time. All right. Okay. Librosa has got a chroma visualization, which now is a different way of seeing what these sounds start looking like and giving us at different pitch frequencies. These are actual notes. But again, we have no idea which instrument, which person, which voice is creating those notes. That's more complex. But we're starting to actually now see in the range of time all the notes that are being played at any point in time in the range from C to B. And we just took a very small slice of note range. And going over the course of 2 minutes, you can now see how these notes lay out over time period. Okay, the Mel frequency sepstral coefficients. I was going to apologize to our stenographer because I didn't put this in my slides earlier. So I'm sorry. Thank you, though. This is a different way of breaking across the sound. Again, visualizing different ways of hearing the harmonics and the vocal singers. I'm going to not talk long about this because this is more math than I could actually understand. And it hurt my head, but this is something that audio engineers and people with PhDs are really loving and talking a lot about. And there's a competition every year. The Music Information Retrieval Society has these competitions to see who can do better at pulling these songs and stuff out. All right, so back to Librosa and beats per minute, feature aggregation. So this is where now we're starting to get to the point of reducing the clutter, the extra sound. So nothing's as cool as CSI when they say, hey, can you zoom in on that fuzzy part in the back and then extrapolate and like let's get it super clear. It's kind of like what the DSP is trying to do is, how can we get one person's voice out of the song and clean that up a lot so we don't hear all the extra sounds? This is a spectrogram showing, which part is this showing? Is this foreground or background? I'm not sure, I apologize. This is just the beat tracker. So now we're able to just find very symmetrical beat patterns going on throughout the song. That's important. Now we can do an analysis through feature aggregation, then start pulling out the Mel coefficient against the beats per sound. And this gets more important as we go along, and we start looking at the chromogram across time, and you can start seeing where we might have a vocal pattern that is gonna follow what the song is. So we can then pull out more important stuff like the person who's singing. One of the coolest libraries I came across is, this is called Nuzzle. This is the Northwestern University Sound Something Labs. This something is not right, but this is an example where I started going through, and this is these are a lot of people that were going through and coming up with really great algorithms and using like what I showed you with Librosa, Aubio. There's a couple of different other audio signal, duet, repeat. It's actually pronounced repeat, F2D2, HPSS. These are different algorithms they have. And again, I was going through trying to understand after I'd spent way too much time learning about Fourier transform. I had to write code, and I was looking at this code and going, okay, this is really cool. I can make this work. People are separating sounds. I can use their work to do this. And so I started doing that, and I started using things like repeat, which is this repeat pattern extraction technique. And it comes out with really interesting what sounds you get at the very end. So I'm going to start with 14A as my output. And I'm playing this right now just on my computer, so you can hear when we're separating out the sound. So now we've actually taken the foreground out, and we're trying to just hear the background noise of what's being played. So we're not trying to hear too much of Bruce singing. We now want to just hear the music. So you can kind of hear him in the background. It's there, but it's very muted. But this is the song, right? We've now eliminated, as much as we can, the singer. That's important. In a good way. In a good way. All right. But the foreground, if we do the similar, if we do the similar sound. It's playing. You have to really love this song.
Right,
just taking the audio signal, the singer. And half the back of the song is gone. All right. So, all right, moving on. Now I'm going to actually start showing you what this sounds like on a piano, because that was the entire intention of all of this. You guys have sat through all this. I'm so sorry. But okay. So I'm going to play to do this, and this is where it gets a little fickle. I'm going to now connect, hopefully, to my Raspberry Pi. Hopefully, I am now in my Raspberry Pi. We're going to play a couple of different examples. I just got to make sure which ones are already over there. Twinkle Twinkle does not. I'm gonna actually try Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. This may or may not work. So. Okay. I will turn the vacuum on. Just wait. A little star, and then I need to actually set the sleep. So one of the things that we learned, beats per minute is really important, especially some of the libraries you're using. If you don't set this, like what you think your time between every event is going to happen in a MIDI file, which is what now, I'm creating MIDI files the entire time, so I'm skipping a whole lot just to get to the fun part. But basically, the entire talk was about getting sound separated. I'm now creating MIDI files. Once I create a MIDI file, I'm using that, sending it to the Raspberry Pi, converting that to SPI, and then SPI is then running this on solenoids, which you're about to hear somewhat. The thing is, you have to make sure when you're creating a MIDI file, you know how many beats per minute you're using as far as what a quarter note is equal to. The library I'm using is a Python MIDI converter. It works in microseconds, and that doesn't help you because math. So let's go with, I'm going to say 10,000. This might go really fast. That didn't work at all. No, that's not going to work. All right. I'm going to take a different song that I know worked earlier. We can try Old Dan Tucker. You guys have sat this long. I should let you at least hear this one. All right. The fun part about this library is that it actually takes a while to build the entire file. There's nothing streaming about it, but it does build the entire file to then put out onto here. I'm going to hold this against here. It's really jankety. All right. Oh, I forgot to set sleep timer. Sorry. It actually, the default is 0.3 seconds, and you know the sleep time by 0.3 versus sleep by like, you know, 1,000, big difference. Big difference. And the reason I have to hold this here is we learned on Tuesday that the tracker bar, which is what this manifold sits up against, has a slight curvature of about 1 millimeter somewhere in the middle, which means all vacuum is gone when we don't have this push there. So I'm gonna hold this. Sounds like the song, right? Nah. All right, I'm gonna kill this one real quick. One other song I wanted to try and get, but I don't know if this will work or not. Some of the examples I had on here, just to make sure I'm getting it in. Nope, that fell apart quickly. All right, so maybe that won't work as well as I'd hoped. No, unfortunately, I'm not going to get the correct file to work right now. I only have one across. Okay, but that is essentially, you know, you're looking at a prototype of what we've been working on. I've got this far with the help of some really great friends like Peter Ziba, who is an amazing circuit board guy who helped me actually do a lot of the hardware part. Carl Karsten helped me put together all this. I should turn that off too. You guys don't need to hear the vacuum, but it makes me feel better, warmer and fuzzier. But basically, a lot of this has just been something that, you know, is a passion of mine that, as much as my wife has been very angry that I spent a lot of time doing this, this allows me now to move forward is to, like, getting the notes separated better and get a better manifold gasket that, you know, if anybody here knows how to, you know, use nitrogen and freeze rubber so we can laser cut it, that'd be helpful. But we're also, you know, looking at other ways to get the sound down, you know, creating better vacuums and putting sound together. What I'd like to do in the future is be able to have a moving piano calliope where I could just have this going down the street, play music on its own, and, you know, it's that scene in Star Wars where Han Solo is in carbonite just going across, you know, Boba Fett's got him. That's kind of what driving this piano is like, but if it could play music, mouths would be open. So what I'd really love to do, and a lot of the libraries that I've been working on and using are old defunct libraries. So almost all of them, no, I'd say about half of what I came up with and was using, Librosa, Aubio, Mido, WAON. These are things that have been out there for 10 plus years that nobody's touched. Maybe it was just like a PhD student who came up with an idea, put this out there and worked on it, and then it didn't go anywhere after they did something with it. And I would love to get some, you know, help and support in finding ways to make this more exciting, especially because I'm trying to get a player piano to play again on its own. So with that, I don't know if I do questions and answers now or, oh yeah, I'm gonna do questions and answers. So thank you all for.
Thanks, JP Bader. That was a good talk. So now we open the floor to questions. So if you do have questions, please, there are two microphones. Walk up, give the question. Try to keep it short because we only have so much time. If you think it's a longer question, maybe you want to talk to him out in the hall about it. And if we run short on time, I'll kind of interrupt you guys. So, okay, we have one question.
Yeah, what's the mechanism of actuating the strings?
So we've got solenoids inside of here. We're using a spy bus that's sending the signals directly to the solenoids. So we're, I don't know if that answers completely your question.
What's the vacuum doing?
Oh, the vacuum, okay. So old school player pianos run on a vacuum system. There's a stack inside of here that has pouches for every single note. Across this tracker bar are 88 holes. These 88 holes each represent literally a binary bit on off. The moment an old piece of paper would be going across that tracker bar, a hole in there, on, no hole, off. So all we're doing is sealing or unsealing the holes to the manifold.
Okay, another question? Oh, on the left.
You mentioned, you mentioned a repository. I was a little bit late, so maybe I missed it, but can we find your work online?
Yes, I'm gonna put, everything will be on GitHub. In the middle on the bottom, Lord Bader, is my GitHub repo. I'll be putting all my notebooks, my slides, and you can yell horrible epithets at me afterwards. But yeah, everything will be online.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You mentioned a lot of different tools that you use to visualize the sound and things like that. Which were the libraries or tools that you actually used to get the sound from the MP3 file to get it to the Raspberry Pi? What are the core pieces?
They're GStreamer, Wave from Python. We're just converting any audio file when I was playing around with this, MP3s and whatnot, to Wave. Melodia was one of the core libraries to convert from any WAV file to MIDI. And then from MIDI itself, there's a Python library that we were just extracting to what they called an opus, and that was what's going to SPI. We built our own converter for sending it to SPI.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wait, we have time for one more. So.
Yeah, how did you get that here? Did you just put it on the back of a truck or
If you wait until I'm done, I will show you how I drove it in here and I will drive it out. It's on a tubular steel frame that I harvested the parts out of an electric wheelchair I bought off a dead guy. And I basically, this is Rev4 of this platform. It's drivable. It goes about 6.5 miles per hour at full speed. So please be careful. But yeah, I threw it in the back of a trailer yesterday morning. Yesterday morning and drove it from Chicago.
If it made ice cream, you'd have a business.
I didn't hear you, I'm sorry.
I said if it made ice cream, then you'd have a business.
It's funny you should mention that. A lot of these ideas start off that way. So many ideas. All right.
Okay, so one more round of applause for our speaker.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. if you'd like